Welcome to Dim Summary. I like
that
the energy.
Loud.
That was good energy.
The music behind me.
Yeah, I think it's all the fog machine. How's this going? How's this hype for Dim Summary?
Like a youth service, you know?
Yeah. So. Riza, welcome to Dim Summary. It's your first time, but it's taken way too long to get
it's
you on
here.
It's
my first time. I'm grateful, I'm excited, and I'm nervous.
Don't be nervous.
This is gonna go good. We get to eat and hang out and talk about the awesome service. So many people may not know you, even though you've been here longer than almost any of us. 15 years on staff? Wow. Okay, so Riza runs our Filipino ministry, which, you know, I'm gonna have in heaven this little shack, but her and her team and her, they're gonna have a mansion.
Yeah.
It's gonna be incredible. They serve our city and each other and our church so well. So we're excited today. It kind of all came together. God wound the pieces from the Share Your Story and Beloved Conference. So you're amazing. Now, you may not know this about Riza either, but I collected some data around the office about what are you known for?
And I thought it was about the food.
Not yet. One of the things I've heard is that you really know how to party. That wherever you go, there are birth. You know how to celebrate. It's one of our staff ethos. You celebrate often, and even karaoke. Wherever you go, you bring a party and you bring some karaoke.
The ladies love to sing and dance.
Okay. So do you yourself sing? Do you have a power jam you kind of go to?
I love to sing, but I don't know how to dance, so I would watch the ladies and learn.
What is the song that you typically sing?
Oh, do you have a go-to song?
Well, I have a morning playlist.
Okay.
Playlist.
Okay, that's awesome. Hey, we have some awesome food to fit this occasion. Can you tell us about what we're going to be eating
yes,
today?
Yes, this brings so much childhood memory. So we have spring roll, our Filipino version of spring roll. And I think this has, these have vegetable fillings. Okay. So, and this is what we call ensaymada, which we would partner with either soft drinks or coffee. And this is...
But tea is okay,
about
right?
Tea
is okay. Yeah. Tea is okay, because we have tea right
ensaymada?
Now.
Ensaymada? What's inside the ensaymada?
Oh, so it's bread. And in the Philippines, we would use margarine and cheese.
Yeah.
We can... here, I think they would use cream cheese and...
It's, it's a cheese bread.
Cheese.
You cheese can and use, butter.
Yes.
I can get into that.
This is really good and filling. And then we have biko. This is always present in every celebration, and we miss eating this in our birthday celebrations. So this is made of glutinous rice and coconut cream and milk and sugar.
Wow. Pass it, because it's
these are all
so
good.
I'm lactose intolerant, but I'm going to
But please try.
I will do it. And pay the consequences later.
We learned about suffering today.
Yeah.
Suffer with
I will groan, for sure. No, just kidding. I don't know why I said that.
It's on air now.
Well, what do you want?
Hey, we'll let pass out food and start eating. I just want to give a shout out. Thank you so much for joining us online. Some of you calling out in Hong Kong where you are, Jeff Ryan in Penny Bay, may God be with you.
Yes.
And may you groan and not grumble. You almost made it. We had some other call-outs, Alice in Seoul, Taiwan, all the way though to Singapore and San Diego with some good fish tacos. So thank you guys for joining us wherever you're at.
Oh, so good.
Pray that God uses, it's so good.
So good.
Yeah. That's
I'm glad
awesome.
You like it.
I'm gonna dig in too. So Riza, we did get a little insight in the service.
Yes.
Through a Share Your Story and hearing about the Beloved Conference with Maying and her story. It just matched so well with the Word of God today as we talked about suffering and hope. And why don't you tell us a little bit about how you've got to know Maying a little bit?
Oh, well, Maying, as she said, as she shared, that she was brought in by Pastor Didi. But I'm just grateful to the Lord to see how she has grown throughout the year. So she is, aside from being a volunteer in children's ministry, she serves as one of our small group leaders. And when we were doing airport ministry, she was my constant partner because that time she was the only one who lives out. So after work, she would come to Quarry Bay to travel with me from Quarry Bay to the airport to give snacks, Tetra Pak juices and cakes or bread and SIM card to those who are arriving here for the first time to work. And it's such a good experience to welcome them, sort of like making them feel home. When they are here. And of course, giving them SIM cards where they can connect right away with their families and say, hey, we arrived safely, we're here. So yeah, it's I'm blessed with her life and seeing her grow in her faith and allowing God to use her in different ways.
So you and Meng were very instrumental in the airport ministry stuff mm-hmm. that you guys were doing, but with COVID and everything, now that has transitioned to another sort of ministry, right?
Yeah, so from that ministry, we now do, because we cannot go to the airport, although back then, Meng was my constant partner, but there are some ladies that would join when the employers allow them. And then now that we cannot go to the airport or we cannot meet them at the airport, we do a hotel quarantine ministry where we would deliver care packets to those who are in quarantine for 21 days with food packs, snacks, literature, that includes Bible. And I'm just surprised and grateful that most of them thank us for the Bible. Yeah. And then there would be personal care packs and SIM packs as well.
Yeah, I love how you and your ministry have pivoted so well in this time. It's not anything that is rocket science. Mm. You just met people when they've had their biggest need, their biggest uncertainty, and just showed up to bless them and to give to them. Yeah.
And I'm just grateful because many ladies are involved, and this ministry is really bounded by love from shopping what we would bring to them, to packing, delivering. So different ladies would volunteer to deliver in different quarantine facilities and different hotels. And then evangelism, we would call them while they're in quarantine, and discipleship. Mm. So this really opens a lot for us in terms of our ministry and opportunity to reach out to the ladies.
So over COVID, just as an estimate, how many new ladies have you just reached out to, shared the gospel with, just showed them God's love?
We have delivered around 300 care packets already.
Wow.
100 plus or 200 plus. We have shared we make sure that we share the gospel to all of our contacts. Yeah. And right now, praise God, we have 18 ladies from the hotel quarantine ministry that are actively involved.
So 80 women who got the packages, they traveled to Hong Kong, stuck in quarantine, they got the package, now they're part of the church.
18. Part of the church. Yeah. Some of them have even gone through the Kairos training and Witnessing for Life evangelism training.
Wow. That's awesome. That's a good motivation for all of us to just think, how can we reach out to people who are in Penny Bay, Jeff Ryan, or who are in quarantine? I was down near the Cary Hotel yesterday and met a church member who was coming to drop off stuff for her husband, and we saw him in the window and we're waving. There's people all around the city who are in need, and maybe they're not in quarantine, but just struggling.
Yeah.
Because stuff has been shut down. Sometimes opportunity has been shut down. And so just to come alongside, and I think you show God's love and open the door for other people to see God's love by showing up. So thank you so much for doing that. And I just want to say that Share Your Story was amazing because it's the story of so many women we've got to know here who embody what Pastor Tim talked about. Because he opened up Romans 8, and they didn't have their mind set in the moment.
Yes.
They were coming with a bigger purpose for God, and then for their family, and then later getting to know their bigger purpose for God, I think enabled them to go through the momentary tough times,
right? You know, we're just so grateful. These past 2 years have been difficult for the ladies, been difficult for their employers as well. It has been difficult that the ladies were not able to go home and see their families for the past 2 years.
Yeah.
But we praise God because they have the right perspective and the right attitude, just that instead of grumbling, they see the goodness of God in this all. Like, yes, they were not able to go home to provide for the family, to go home to visit their family, right? But when lockdown happened in the Philippines and nobody could work except them, they are here working because their bosses have worked, they have worked, and they are able to provide for the family. So I'm just grateful for these past 2 years that nobody got sick, nobody has to go home just because they lost their job.
Yeah.
God really kept us together.
Yeah, it's so powerful that a lot of your women have embodied a lot of what Pastor Tim preached about, the difference between grumbling and groaning. Now, I have so many questions about that. Do you? But my main struggle is, how do I hold on to that hope? How do I get that hope? Because that seems to be the main part of the message, was you got to find that hope or that optimism.
Yeah.
That's so hard. How do you guys do it? Like,
Yeah, how do you hold on to that?
Mm. Or even get it, you know?
Yeah.
For a lot of us who don't have that hope.
Yeah, I think if you don't, some of us, the call is to remember, right? Stuff we've been built in. But if you don't have it, that's a chance to dive in and develop a foundation where some of the classes of the Foundation Four or just getting in a Bible study where you're opening up God's word and get to hear, you get a foundation.
Yeah.
Because if you just know, oh, there's a God out there, but you don't know his plan, you're not learning his heart, it's ambiguous and aimless for your heart. There's not a place to rest. But when you start learning some foundational truths, what is his plan for me? How does this all end?
Yeah.
How is he protecting me when it seems like I'm not being protected? You know, if you don't know those things, it's very hard not to start grumbling, right? Mm. Groaning and hope only come when you have an idea either what's coming or who's bringing it and they're trustworthy. Yeah. So I would say diving in and developing a foundation. And that's really important. I was thinking about when Tim was talking about grumbling and groaning. One of the bad sides of what I do is my groaning, probably the healthier side, tends to just be inside in my thoughts. And my grumbling tends to be outward. Mm. And it's contagious. Mm-hmm. And so when I think of the amazing power of the ladies, their testimony, I see their joy is contagious in my life through suffering. Yeah. When I think about what I do outward, it's probably contagious the other way.
Yep.
And so that's also a dynamic that I've got to become aware of.
It's easy to jump on in the grumbling train, isn't it?
Yeah.
It's kind of fun, actually. It's like therapeutic to do that.
Yeah, yeah. So I've got to make my holy groaning louder so people learn how to step into that and then make my grumbling a little quieter. Teach my heart. So that's something I always think about, as Tim was talking about.
Yeah.
Yeah. Can you tell the distinction in your life when it happens, or is it only looking at the autopsy later of what happened that you could tell?
Yeah. It's looking at the autopsy after, seeing like the destruction, the wake of destruction left behind me in my grumbling, that I thought, oh, maybe I shouldn't have done that. But
yeah,
I think it is really hard to capture that hope mentality.
Yeah.
I'm reading a book called The Recapture of Wonder. And the author was basically writing about the need to find the enchantment of the world, the enchantment of the cosmos, like how mysterious and wonderful it is. Mm. And that is like really what our hope is. There's something that is so mysterious and uncertain about how Jesus will come back.
Yeah.
What the new kingdom will be like,
yeah.
But we have lost the enchantment of it.
Mm.
We've thought, intellectualized everything. We've thought through everything. We're very cognitive people, and so then there's no wonder. Like when you really think about hope, like when you have hope for Christmas morning, you're like, man, what is the mystery of that present? Like, what is that gonna be? You're excited, right?
Yeah.
And we've lost that in a lot of ways, and what we even hope for.
Yeah.
That's what I was struggling with when Tim was preaching. I was like, man, I do know that Jesus is coming back, but why am I not so overly excited about it that it becomes like the hope that I hold on to?
That's good. That's really good. When I think about the hope of heaven and wondrous, I don't really have a problem with dying. I have a problem with what gets to dying and suffering.
Yeah.
I think that's my problem. We all like, heaven's gonna be great, but that suffering that may lead to the death that gets there is what I'm fearful of. And I feel like we're just taught not to suffer, not to go through pain, to avoid pain, to build program around, disciplines around, so you don't have to go through pain. Mm-hmm. I feel like that's an area where we can grow of, not to run from pain as it's always a bad thing. Suffering as if it's always the wrong thing, an evil thing, a bad thing. But to sometimes embrace it, to say, God, what are you doing in this? Or what could you do as a part of this? How could I be formed? Because I really feel like God is way more concerned about our formation, who we're becoming, than our momentary circumstance.
Yeah.
I don't think he fears suffering the way we fear suffering.
Yeah.
And I'm the first we need to say, I fear suffering.
Yeah, for sure.
We all do, but I think it's good to know that, sometimes God allows us suffering so that we can depend on him.
Yeah.
And the hope that it brings in the future is really nothing compared to what we are going through right now, because it's all earthly and temporal, but the glory that awaits us is heavenly and eternal.
Yeah, totally.
So what is one small, like, for someone who doesn't have that hope right now, or is struggling to like really believe in that hope, what is one small practical thing they can be doing to be remembering that hope or you know, looking forward to what's coming?
One thing that's hard to say.
Just one.
Well, the basic thing we talk about every week is if you go through it alone, you get in isolation, you're so vulnerable. Suffering in isolation or by yourself, not sharing your story, not having someone to carry you is the most dangerous thing. It's foundational, but it's what we run to. We run and hide and we don't want anyone to know. But so I just say that if whatever you're feeling right now is really difficult and no one else knows it, like knows what's going on, no one else can check on you, can help speak truth to you when it's kind of dark. I mean, that's number one in my book, is because we all can't see straight or think straight when the waves are crashing over us and we need someone who can help us. So number one is find someone for sure to suffer with.
Yeah, I think for me, it's good to remember the time when God has answered your prayer, the time when God has provided, the time when God healed.
Yeah.
It's the same God that does not change, and it's the same God that will work it out for us, whatever we are going through right now.
Yeah, that's really good.
Good way to do that. I think there was a sermon about a year ago, I think Pastor Albert preached it, like the blessing journal, the praise journal.
Yeah.
Like things to be thankful of every single day, or prayers that you have, and you're recording it so that you can look back frequently and find when God has answered it.
Yes.
We don't do it. We pray for a lot of things and then we go on with our day and it's answered, but we don't see it. And that's the, you know, I think that's a tragedy that we don't see how God is actually working.
Yeah, that's so good. We'll wrap up there. I think of one of the things when I did a leadership practice, and I think we offer one of the classes here, is they have you zoom out and look at the timeline of your life, of how God has been active in work. And so if you get stuck on this little blip in the timeline, zoom out a little bit. Look how God has been present. Remember his blessings. See how he's come through and answered your prayers. And so zoom out a little bit and trust God. So thank you guys for joining us. Reza, thank you for joining us.
Thank
I hope you,
you
do
you
it
for
again.
Having me.
Thank you for
you
offering
didn't eat anything.
Awesome food.
Later.
Oh, later, yeah. Later. Okay. Hey. In the words of Selena online, I'd never heard this phrase, a big cyber hug to all you in Dim Summary Land. Thanks for joining us. I'm gonna use that from now on.
Cyber hug.
Cyber hug.
Yeah. Cyber bye. Say bye in the chat, okay? We'll see you guys.
Bye. We love you, church. We'll see you next week. Thanks for
God
joining.
God bless you.